Hrvatskoj hitno trebaju društveno odgovorni lideri u privatnom i javnom sektoru. Oni koji ne prepoznaju ovaj globalni trend održivog poslovanja završit će bankrotom, poslovnim, moralnim i političkim. Što je to transformacijsko vodstvo i kako postati organizacija spremna za budućnost? Samo za drugu stranu govori globalni guru društveno-odgovornog poslovanja, pisac, futurist, konzultant i bivši direktor istraživanja sveučilišta Cambridge, profesor Wayne Visser. Rođen u Zimbabveu, odrastao u Južnoj Africi, doktorirao u Engleskoj na temi što motivira lidere da postanu društveno-odgovorni. Napisao je 28 knjiga, bio konzultant Coca-Cola, Dela, HSBC-a, Svjetske banke, direktor istraživanja sveučilišta Cambridge i direktor odjela održivosti u KPMG-u. Ono što je Adam Smith u ekonomiji i Kotler u marketingu, to je Wayne Visser u društveno-odgovornom poslovanju. Professor Visser, welcome to Creation Radio Television.
Thank you.
Who is actually Wayne Visser? Preacher, believer, consultant, economist, or businessman who can prove us that a social responsibility is profitable on the long run?
Well, I like to think of myself as a pracademic, a practical academic. And what I like is to take the best of the ideas and the best of the practice. Because ideas without implementation are not worth anything, but implementation without good ideas is also a waste.
And they believe to you, otherwise it would not ask you to be a consultant.
Yeah, well, I think I've managed to have a career for 30 years working on sustainable business, which is a surprise to me even, but that tells us how the world has changed, because the need is there today.
What is corporate social responsibility? Is it just a marketing gimmick, PR tool, ethical question, legal hedging, sales product? What is this term?
Well, I think it's a much misunderstood and maligned term, and it's in fact all of the things you mentioned. But the way that I try to make sense of it is that it's nothing new. The idea of business having an ethical impact goes back thousands of years. But in fact, if we look to the 1870s with people like Rockefeller, people like Carnegie, they were already thinking about
Quakers and,
exactly, the Quakers, about the impact that they could have through their business. But what we see today really is that it means different things to different people depending on how mature they are. Mm-hmm. So for some it's a defensive risk management strategy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. For some it's all about charity and philanthropy. Others indeed use it as PR, as promotion and marketing. And for some it's more strategic. All of those approaches.
But everybody will claim that this is a strategic approach for their company, so how can we differentiate those companies? Who is really socially responsible and what for?
Yeah, well, I think you have to judge the patient in terms of sickness by whether they're getting better or worse. So is our society and is our planet getting better or worse? In those terms, all forms of social responsibility have completely failed. So as a strategy for positive social change, CSR is a failure today. But that doesn't mean to say it has to be going forward. So how do we test? Well, are companies willing to admit that they're part of the problem, that the industrial, economic, capitalist system that we have is creating a fundamental set of breakdowns in society? Do they admit that? And then are they prepared to be ambitious? And that's really what differentiates companies today between those old approaches and what I call a transformational approach. Will they set ambitious goals for being part of the solution, not part of the problem?
And to survive.
Well, they have to survive, but there's a lot of confusion. Companies saying our purpose is to make profits, to return to shareholders. Well, that's like saying my purpose is to breathe. It's nonsense. Yeah, I have to breathe to survive. Companies have to make profits to survive, and you have to be prosperous in order to invest. But that's not the purpose of a company. The purpose of business is to deliver value to society. And that's what we're in now, in a decade of questioning. What do we mean by value? And in fact, are companies creating value with the one hand and destroying value with the other hand?
But how did CSR term evolve? At the very beginning, it was, you mentioned, it was charity, from charity to corporate necessity. Maybe we should mention also that Enron had certain CSR rules, but it was not bulletproof shield. So, what's the purpose of CSR if it's not bulletproof shield for a company or a shelter?
Well, that's the problem, I think, is that CSR has been used as a way, we often say, to give back to society. Mm-hmm. Well, immediately that should tell you that we've taken something away. And so we haven't been questioning how companies make their money, but rather so long as they're generous in giving something back, then we're okay. And that's just such an outdated, old-fashioned model. We tried it in the West for 100 years and discovered that it just isn't credible. You don't get the social license to operate. You don't build the trust that you need through that approach because the public or your customers realize very quickly that with the one hand, you're having negative impacts, maybe much bigger negative impacts through your processes, through your products, and on the other hand, you're giving a little bit of charity. It doesn't work anymore. So the evolution today is from that old concept of CSR to actually reforming business, to actually reinventing the purpose of business, how we do business, in other words, how we do the process, how we do the products. It's very much more an innovation agenda today, not a compliance or a risk or a PR agenda.
So the problem is not solved yet?
No, and it's not going to be solved for a long time. But what we see is a kind of solidarity among international countries. Whereas maybe two decades ago, if the United States pulled out of something, we would have said, okay, well, that won't work now. Mm-hmm. Now we go ahead. And what you see is within the United States, mayors, companies completely ignoring the Trump administration position and just saying, we've recognized the science, we know we want to be on the right side of history, we're going ahead. And so in a way, I think we're really rediscovering democracy as a result of some of these moves backwards that we're seeing at the national political level.
How will you convince these companies to implement such as CSRs?
Well, I think there is a business case for implementing CSR, but you have to do it at a deep level. You have to say that this is a long-term commitment. Mm-hmm. This is about showing that we really are contributing to society in a positive way. Those that are getting caught out, that are perhaps, there's this saying by Warren Buffett that it's only when the tide goes out that you see who's been swimming naked.
Yeah.
And what we discovered in the financial crisis, a lot of companies were very naked in terms of CSR. They'd been giving to charity, but they hadn't changed anything fundamentally. So the way you convince companies is firstly to say, look, the society is changing. The norms are changing. What would make you successful today and tomorrow is not what would make you successful yesterday.
But on the other hand, there are companies that are not socially responsible, also making a huge profits. For instance, gambling industry, alcohol, tobacco industry, and doing extremely well, actually. Exactly. And why would they switch to CSR?
You're absolutely right. In fact, in the United States, there's something called the Vice Fund, which will mm-hmm. only invest in those so-called sin industries.
And they're performing well on the stock exchange.
Perform very well. And the reason for that is that our market incentives are all wrong. We're not pricing in the social and environmental cost of economic activity. We're starting to see some changes there. We get big companies like PwC and KPMG starting to introduce new methodologies to measure mm-hmm. that impact financially. But for them, why would they engage in this? Well, to be honest, it's a case of Do they really believe they will be around in 20 years?
You mentioned occasionally Unilever as an example of a good CSR practice. What we can learn from this case?
In fact, sustainability experts around the world have been surveyed every year. In the last 8 years, Unilever has been voted as the most sustainable company. And that's a lot to do with their leadership. Paul Polman, the CEO, has a very clear vision for a sustainable mm-hmm. future. They have something called the Sustainable Living Plan. And the interesting thing is that that's their corporate strategy. They don't have a sustainability or CSR strategy here and a corporate strategy there. It is their corporate strategy. And what we can mainly learn from him as a CEO and Unilever in general is they've turned themselves into a purpose-driven company. And the purpose in their case, Sustainable Living Plan, is to double in size while halving environmental impacts. So in other words, growing without any additional environmental impact, helping 1 billion people out of poverty, and ensuring that 100% of their products, agricultural products, are certified sustainable. As a result, the brands that are growing the fastest in the Unilever stable are the brands that are linked to sustainability. And so it tells us that if you will commit to that strategic, purpose-driven strategy, then you will benefit. But take note that they've said to the market, we're not going to report quarterly anymore, because that's the wrong kind of incentive. That's short-term behavior. So we need companies like that who will really take that stand. As a result, 1.7 million people every year apply to work for Unilever. People want to work for a company that they can believe in, that's making a positive difference.
When Coca-Cola realized that they have a CSR problem?
Yeah, well, they have a few problems, but one of them was water. You know, they got caught out in the district of Kerala in India, and they were accused of stealing the water.
Which is true.
Well, they're a big water consumer. They're not the only industry, and also agriculture is using water in that area. But the lesson for them was to realize that water was their strategic issue, that that's the thing they've got to solve. So they invest a lot in the water independence of their communities. The water independence of their communities, but also in becoming water neutral as a company. That means they won't take a single drop of water out of nature that they won't put back into nature as clean or cleaner than they took it out. So that's a huge commitment. But the lesson also to learn there is they didn't change their strategy. All they did is align an issue with their strategy. And so for them to really become transformative, they have to look at other things like, what's the link to obesity with their products? Is there something they need to change there? They're doing a lot on women in leadership, by the way. So they're having a positive impact. But on the water issue, even in California, Nestle, for example, got caught out because, you know, they got a bottling plant in California in the middle of a drought for bottled water. So, far rather go for a good Croatian example like, what's it called, Friva? Yeah, Friva, which allows you to fill up water in spots around the city.
Well, to switch from the CSR 1.0, which was a previous approach to CSR, to CSR 2.0, you need leaders. Where you think that we can find leaders? Well, there are not so many Steve Jobs or Elon Musk around.
I think it's not the lack of these leaders. They're not always the charismatic ones. In fact, they're often the humble, the quiet leaders. But they see the purpose-driven approach as a way to make profits, to make prosperity.
But how can they influence the board? You know, you to approve certain strategy, you have to convince the board that this is the right approach and that this approach will make a profit. And that this is a good for shareholders, for a company, for, I don't know, board special bonus or whatever. So it's hard to do that.
It is hard, and we see that these leaders have a different set of competencies or skills than any other leader. We studied this at Cambridge University at the Institute for Sustainability Leadership, and we see that these are people who are very skilled in seeing the system's interaction, so seeing how things are connected. They're very ethically driven, so they're able to use their values to persuade. They're able to also sell that long-term story. But really what we're talking about here are champions of change. They're change makers, and what they're able to do is to take what they know to be a better solution and translate it into the language of their company, of their industry.
It seems that CSR is a market necessity for private companies. What about the public companies and the government? Who should lead the changes, the private or the public?
Well, I think these are companies that in a way you would expect to have a positive social impact. They almost have a public mandate to do that. And the issue there is, are we holding them accountable? I think that government has a much stronger role to play today than they did maybe 50 years ago or 20 years ago. But it has to be in the right way. So public procurement, especially of public companies, is something where they can make a real impact by having criteria that include things like diversity or inclusive economic strategies or indeed environmental impacts or social responsibility.
But now we have a dilemma. Implementing CSR is costly. East European countries have to catch up with the Western economies in GDP per capita or industry development or whatever, efficiency. Should they postpone social responsible principles until they reach the level of the Western Europe or not?
Yeah, I think this is a fallacy. I think that for one thing, we don't have the time. I mean, the problems we face are urgent and getting worse very quickly. And these are problems that are not out there. They're problems that you will feel locally as well. And whether it's disparity, indeed corruption, climate change, these are things that are going to affect you in the short term. But what I'm quite excited about, I've traveled a lot now to 75 countries, and what I see in emerging economies or economies, you know, post-transition, is that there's a lot of entrepreneurship. And so there is this opportunity to leapfrog over. You don't have to go through, you know, the old, exactly, the old dirty industrialization process. You can look for the opportunities. And when we look at the growth markets are in sustainable and responsible areas. And so this idea that you have to wait, I think, is a complete fallacy. I'd rather say we're going to tap in to where the action is. And the action is in the area of clean technology, of inclusive markets, the whole sort of exponential economy, or, you know, the Internet of Things, and the software movement. These are things where I think you don't have to be, a very rich country in order to innovate, and we see that in many countries.
So, did you see anybody from Eastern Europe who is leading in CSR trend?
Yeah, well, I think here I mentioned the case I like, which was Friva. Mm-hmm. And, not only are they promoting the idea that access to clean water should be free, you shouldn't mm-hmm. have to buy a bottle, especially a plastic bottle, which is made from oil and has climate change impacts. You know, this is an example of an innovator right here. And we were speaking to them over the last few days about, can they spread this to some of the islands of Croatia where water really is a problem? Can they spread it to other countries? But I think there are other good practices I've become aware of. So you've got Ericsson, Nikola Tesla. What I've heard is that they have very good employment practices. And further around in the region, I think we have, I remember a few years ago visiting Slovenia, and they have something I really like, which is a certification for companies being family friendly. Mm-hmm. And I really like that, because social responsibility is not just about giving money to charity. It's about, are you really looking after your employees? And that means not just your employees, but their families as well. Do you have daycare? Do you have proper work-life balance? And so on. So I like that. If we go also fairly close to home here, in Kosovo, we were just there a few weeks ago. You have some really interesting things going on there. Again, young entrepreneurs, two women who've set up a piece of software, an application called Walk Freely. And this is allowing women who are sexually harassed on the street to immediately report it and map it using their mobile phones.
Well, we see that the world is changing, corporate culture is changing, leaders are transforming. It seems that you also evolve and transform yourself from writer to producer. After 28 books, you switch to film industry. Closing the loop. Is it symbolic?
Well, partly I think it is about, how can we make the most impact? And you wonder today who reads books anymore sometimes. So indeed, one of the shifts I made recently, I co-produced a documentary called Sinking Nation, which is about climate change on a Pacific island. But also this most recent one, Closing the Loop, which is all about how we get to a circular economy, which is effectively a zero waste economy. Which people were thinking is something like a dream, but no.
Imagination.
No. Yeah. So what we did, I really wanted to show that it is possible, and that there are companies already, not only in Europe, but also in Latin America, in Africa, where we filmed, that are already implementing this. So no matter where you are, what kind of country you are, how rich or poor you are, there are ways to already move towards a zero waste economy, a circular economy. Instead of the linear take, make, waste,
yes,
we go to, you know, take, borrow, and return. In fact, this suit that I'm wearing, as it happens, was one of the cases we filmed. It's a company called Dutch Awareness, and it's a circular suit.
So what does it mean? That few of you are sharing the same suit or not?
Luckily not. What it means is that they've innovated the fabric, so it's a polyester fabric which can be 100% recycled, not once, but 8 times. So this suit that might have had a 5-year life now has multiple lives of maybe 40 or 50 years. And at the end of that, in fact, they're working with a construction company called Durafamir in Netherlands to use this as a construction material so that they can reinforce the dikes and the canals instead of using tropical hardwood, which is what we use at the moment. So it's just to say that there are these inspiring cases. They're not all from rich countries, but we have to take it seriously.
And but how expensive then this suit is?
This is no more than you would pay for a good suit anywhere else. And that's really important, because if we only have sustainable or socially responsible products that you pay more for, it'll never be a solution for everyone. It'll always be an exclusive little club of ethical consumers. It won't solve the problem. So CSR, sustainable business, it has to be a solution for everyone. And we need, therefore, to have what we call frugal innovation, innovation that doesn't cost more, solutions that are sustainable and affordable. And there's a lot happening in this space, which is very exciting. So, you know, don't wait for the West or for the rest of the world to lead the charge. You can do it wherever you are, in whatever position you are. You can make a change.
Professor Visser, thank you very much for your precious time.
Thank you so much.
Evo, bio je ovo Wayne Visser, globalni propovjednik društveno odgovornog poslovanja i transformacije lidera. A sad malo pogledajte oko sebe i potražite vođu koji o vašoj firmi, županiji, državi promišlja na novi način. Onaj koji ima budućnost. Nit vodilja nek vam bude rečenica: Steve Jobs i Elon Musk nisu radili da bi zaradili novac, nego da bi mijenjali svijet. Kad tako radite, novac će doći sam od sebe. Poštovani gledatelji, hvala na pažnji. Vidimo se za tjedan dana u isto vrijeme i na istom mjestu. Doviđenja.